So this is the point at which we step back and try to extract some very general lessons about the nature of the problems that we have encountered so far. We solved a number of one-dimensional quantum problems, the particle in the box and some of its variants leading to tunneling, as well as a harmonic oscillator, and on the way it seems that things have become increasingly more complicated. We solved differential equations using operators and their eigenvalues and eigenstates, where we borrowed concepts from vectors and matrices. And we also introduced different types of integrals, for instance for the normalization of the wave function, the Fourier transform, and the expectation values. But at this moment it is not quite clear how these different concepts are related to each other, and it would be useful if you could bring some structure into this. As it happens, this can be done when we deepen the analogy of these objects with vectors and matrices just a little bit further. And we can do this in a very convenient compact notation, the so-called Dirac notation, which is really the universal language of quantum mechanics. This will simplify our calculations, and as I show in this segment, also allow us to derive some very general relations and statements. And it also allows us to focus on the mathematical and physical essence of these objects, which we will use just a little bit later to formulate the general rules of quantum mechanics in a very compact form. In this notation, we denote a quantum state by the following symbol, a vertical line followed by the name of the state, which is here just psi, and then a right-pointing angle bracket. Now, physically, we interpret this as the quantum state, and mathematically, this is just a vector. What this analogy to vectors then really emphasizes is the general rule by which we can combine different states into new ones. Just as vectors, we can add these states linearly with arbitrary constants in front of them. This is really the most general manifestation of the superposition principle. We can also give this new state a name, which just reminds us of how we arrived at it. So now it is useful to reflect how vectors typically appear in physical contexts. For instance, they can be used to designate a point in a space, just as here sketched in two dimensions. For this, we would introduce a coordinate system, and then record the coordinates of the point as the components of a coordinate vector. But this coordinate vector is just part of the information. We also need to agree which coordinate system we are using. Think for instance what happens when you rotate a coordinate system in space and how this changes the coordinates of a point. So importantly, when we introduce this symbol here, we think of the state itself, which already exists in its own right, even before we introduce some sort of coordinate system, formally a basis, to characterize it in terms of its components. Now the states that we have encountered so far are wave functions, and we can convert them into a vector in the following way. We can take a set of equally spaced points along the x-axis, and record the values of this function at these points into a vector, and then we can take the limit that the spacing between these points becomes vanishingly small. Now, because our functions are continuous, this is capturing all the information that we need. For instance, this suffices to work out derivatives and integrals, which indeed involve the same type of limit which I have described here. But this is just one way to record all of this information. For instance, we could also write down the wave function as a sum of plane waves. And these different representations of this information are simply related by the Fourier transformation. As we have already seen in our discussion of the momentum probabilities, the momentum wave function was indeed just another way to talk about the position wave function. Now, the language that we are presently developing will tell us that this is really just a change of our basis, from the basis of position eigenstates to the basis of momentum eigenstates. And if you recall this, I already showed you earlier how you can write the wave function as integrals involving both types of eigenstates. And we can look at these integrals just as a continuous version of a sum over basis vectors. Now we can see how this analogy between states and vectors is useful when we consider what the length of such a state would be. When we start with a vector with discrete components, we would write it down as given here. This is the squared length, written in a way that makes sure that this is always a positive real number, even in the complex case, with the exception of the zero vector with vanishing components for which the length vanishes. Now we can write this also as a dot product when we make use of a complex conjugation. And it is also useful to think of this as a matrix multiplication between a row and a column vector. This simply gives you a 1x1 matrix and therefore just a number. And furthermore, the row vector which we have here is obtained from the column vector by a transposition and a complex conjugation, which is a very standard operation that we carry out on vectors and matrices. It is known as the Hermitian conjugation, and we denote it by a dagger. Now, taking the limit where this vector becomes a function, the sum becomes an integral, and voila, we have our normalization integral. You can, of course, also take the dot product between two different vectors, and when we also do this with this integral, what we obtain then we call the overlap integral. And mathematically, we call these complex versions of the dot product a scalar product. This is a bit similar to when we earlier had averages that we called expectation values and standard deviations that we called uncertainties. So now we have this mathematical scalar product that in this physical manifestation we call the overlap integral. And with this, we can write down the Fourier transformation in a very compact form. That's indeed amazingly compact, but you can check it by simply introducing our definitions. This hides that this is an integral and instead emphasizes that this has a geometrical interpretation. If you recall this from the general theory of vectors, this really looks like the dot product between a basis vector and a vector, which you would use to project out the corresponding coordinate. This works when we are operating in an orthogonal normalized basis, a so-called orthonormal basis. Now we already know what we mean by normalized, namely that this normalization integral here is just one. But with our scalar product, we can now also define what we mean by orthogonal, namely simply that it vanishes between two different states. And if you use this overlap integral, you can check that this is indeed true for any two different position eigenstates. And we can also check this for any two different momentum eigenstates. So with this, we can then liken these two sets of eigenstates to an orthonormal basis, which we then can use to simplify our calculations. Now, so far I've taken care to explain all of this using standard vector notation, but to translate this into our compact Dirac notation, we therefore need two things. A symbol for this complex conjugated vector, which we call the dual state, and we write it like this, with a left pointing angle bracket and then the name of the state and then a vertical line. And a symbol for the scalar product, and we write it like given here, which really looks like a product between a dual state and a normal state with a vertical line removed. And we will indeed agree to always substitute this product of states by the scalar product, so that this just becomes a complex number. Now, as I indicate here, this rule is somewhat magical. It already completes our notation, it will simplify all our calculations, and it will allow us to easily derive some very general relations, as I will show a little bit later in this segment. For instance, this rule already covers operators, because we can write them in terms of products of states and dual states. Hence, in the opposite order of the scalar product, when you apply this to a state and then apply the rule, you just obtain a different state. A general operator can then be written as a sum of such terms, and we will use this very soon. By the way, people like to reflect on this magic by applying a special notion to the symbols, where you call the state a cat and a dual state a bra, so that the scalar product becomes a bracket. Because of this, the Dirac notation is also known as the bracket notation. Mathematically, what we ended up with is known as a Hilbert space, which is simply a vector space with a scalar product, and the added feature that it is complete in a very similar way in which the real numbers complete the rational numbers. This simply means that we never have a problem to find a complete basis, even though the Hilbert space might have infinite dimensions. And we already exploited this when we converted the wave functions to vectors. The scalar product always fulfills a few rules that help us in our calculations. For instance, when you take the scalar product with a superposition, you simply can multiply all terms out in the most natural way. Furthermore, when you interchange the two entries in the product, you just end up with a complex conjugation. You can immediately check this with the overlap integral, and it simply applies to any scalar product. Now, when we combine these two rules, we see that when we have a superposition in the first entry, we can also multiply all terms out, but we have to be a little bit careful with the numbers because they appear with a complex conjugation. And again, this can be directly seen when you look at this example of the overlap integral. So this is the only place where we ever have to be a little bit careful. But now, fortunately, this can also be formulated as a simple rule just for the dual states themselves, which form the so-called dual Hilbert space. So again, when you look at a superposition of dual states, you simply have to take care of this complex conjugation. And finally, there is just one more general feature of the scalar product, and this makes sure that we can use it to define the length of a state. And this guarantees that the scalar product of the state with itself is always a positive real number, again with exception of the zero state, which is defined in analogy to the zero vector and has a zero length. And to these states we can apply operators, but this is fortunately already covered by our notation. First of all, we can give the resulting state a convenient name that just reminds us of how we obtained it. And secondly, when we want to define these operators and use them in calculations, we can rely on our rule given above. This relies on the fact that all the operators that we deal with are linear, which simply means that when they act on a superposition, we can again multiply out all terms. To see how this all works in practice, let us start with a simple example where we multiply a state by a number. As agreed upon before, we denote the resulting state as a psi. When we insert this into the scalar product, we can pull the number in front, but with a complex conjugation when it appears in the first entry. So we can actually use the scalar product to define complex conjugation. Furthermore, we can then give a condition that a number is real, namely that it does not matter whether you multiply to the first or to the second entry. So we can use the scalar product to write this down as a simple condition. Now we can of course also take one of our operators and apply it to this state. As before, I give the resulting state the name a psi. And now comes an important definition. When we insert this into the scalar product, we can always find another operator denoted here as a dagger that gives us exactly the same result when we apply it to the other state. We call this operator the Hermitian conjugate operator. Indeed, if you work this out in an orthonormal basis, where A is just a matrix, then the matrix for A dagger would be obtained by a transposition and a complex conjugation, hence a Hermitian conjugation as I already described above. And now there is a very important class of operators for which A dagger is the same as A. We call these operators Hermitian. That's again the same notion that we would apply to matrices. And as it happens, X and P and all the Hamiltonians that we encounter in quantum mechanics are examples of Hermitian operators. To see how these operators are special, recall how numbers and operators meet in the eigenvalue equation. I have here written this down in Dirac notation, so let us first have a look what the symbols mean in this context. Little a is the eigenvalue, and I also use it to label the corresponding eigenstate. So we are going to assume that there is exactly one such state for each eigenvalue, but the more general case isn't much more complicated. And furthermore, using the Dirac notation, we can also write down a second version of this eigenvalue equation simply for the dual state, where the complex conjugated eigenvalue appears. Now we can show in a few short lines that the eigenvalues of such Hermitian operators are real, and that the eigenstates with different eigenvalues are then orthogonal to each other. For this, we just take the scalar product of the eigenvalue equation with the same eigenstate or with a different eigenstate. And if you look at this, the second version of the eigenvalue equation now appears in these expressions, so we can extract the eigenvalue with a complex conjugation from this. And when we now compare the two sides of the first equation, then we see that the eigenvalue indeed needs to be real. And in the second expression, we see that the eigenvalues are multiplied by the same scalar product, so that if these eigenvalues are different, the scalar product must vanish, which means that the corresponding eigenstates are indeed orthogonal to each other. What this all means is that we can take the eigenstates of a Hermitian operator, and when we also normalize them, we obtain an orthonormal basis that is linked to the specific operator. And we have already seen this, of course, for the position and the momentum operators. Now we can use this to write any Hermitian operator in a very compact form. This is this expression given here, which is a sum involving all the eigenvalues, as well as the corresponding eigenstates and dual eigenstates. Notice that these states are again multiplied in the opposite order than in our rule above, so that this does not apply, but we need this rule to see that this expression is indeed an operator. For this, we apply it to any state, and then we see that all these scalar products appear, and the result is simply a superposition. And furthermore, if we apply this to an eigenstate and use the orthogonality and normalization of these states, we see that it automatically fulfills the eigenvalue equation. And because this holds for any eigenstate and these states form a complete basis, this is all that we need to check. To show how this is useful, I've here written down another expression involving a sum of the eigenvalues, multiplied now by suitable weights P of A. The weights are defined using the scalar product between the corresponding eigenstate and an arbitrary state psi. Now we can use our rules to rearrange this expression as shown, and then we see that in the middle we have our compact form of this operator A. So we can rewrite this as a scalar product between the state psi and itself with the operator A inserted into the middle. Now we have exploited this relation already before. This was the shortcut that allowed us to calculate the expectation values of position and momentum in a very direct way. There, the scalar products in the weights just reduce to the position and momentum wave functions, and the sum becomes an integral. Now we see that this relation holds for any Hermitian operator A. And furthermore, the original expression would be an expectation value if the eigenvalues A would be the outcomes of an experiment, and the weights P of A the corresponding probabilities. This is not what we will agree upon right now, but gives you an idea where we may be heading. So this is certainly very useful and general, and we could obtain this in a few short lines. So let me give you just one more example that shows how we can use this notation to this effect. Using the special compact form of the operators above, we can consider pairs of operators that have the same eigenstates, but possibly different eigenvalues. And now we can check that using the orthogonality of these states, it does not matter in which order we apply these operators to a given state. So A times B gives the same result applied to the state as B times A. And we can of course quantify this in terms of the commutator that I earlier introduced for position and momentum. So the difference between A times B and B times A, which simply vanishes for these special pairs of operators. Now we calculated the commutator of X and P before, and we found that it is IH bar. So this is finite, and this now simply means that they cannot have the same eigenstates. Now physically this means that there are no states in which both position and momentum is well defined. We can of course further quantify this using the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which really is just a technical statement from the theory of Fourier transformations. But with the language developed here, one can also derive another uncertainty principle, known as the Robertson uncertainty principle, which simply involves the commutator between two operators, as shown here. Again, the derivation is a little bit technical, but if you insert the commutator of position and momentum here, you again recover Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So I hope this illustrates the power and utility of this notation. We already used it to derive some very general mathematical relations and read off physical consequences that give us some really new insights. And we also have unified our description considerably. For instance, see that all the three mentioned integrals are really just related to the scalar product. And very soon we will use it to formulate the general rules of quantum mechanics. But before we do so, I also want to show you how you can use this notation to solve quantum mechanical problems. For this, we will return to the harmonic oscillator and obtain its energies and eigenstates in a completely different way.